By the time King Lee Kuan Yew left office, Singaporean kids were recording better scores in mathematics than the American and European counterparts, even though they started off worse. Today, Western educationists are going on training in Singapore. The point being underscored here is that we now live in the knowledge economy. The world has moved beyond the agrarian, industrial, and information ages. Therefore, for us to compete in this new world, we must consciously create the conditions that will allow our people to become knowledge workers and knowledge entrepreneurs. Our young people, largely on their own, have shown that they are ready to be active players in and contributors to this age. How do we support them with the enabling environment? And if that is too difficult for us to do, how do we ensure that we do not impede their progress? Most importantly, how do we ensure that we guarantee quality education to our young citizens across all strata while ensuring that our educational system adapts to the realities of the moment? Those are some of the challenges we have to deal with, and we must begin by cultivating a conscious leadership grooming system. We need a pipeline for that. But even before then, it is also obvious that we are not putting our best to the job. We have well-educated and well-experienced people in our country, young men and women who have both the passion to serve and the right values, but we are not using them to run the most critical part of our national life, which is government. The challenge of Nigeria is to put a politics that enables the emergence of a culture that supports merit in the public arena. Lee Kuan Yew was able to institutionalize meritocracy because he had the ability to work together with his colleagues to refashion a new culture and expectations. How do we do it in Nigeria? Some have read the Singaporean example to mean that we need an authoritarian logic to create such a system. I disagree. I believe we can create a meritocratic system without necessarily changing our social structure. But that is an issue for another day. Pastor Kwaju, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, in case I have been unable to convince the audience about the superiority of knowledge economy over luggage economy, let me now end with a story told by Oliver Bockman in the Guardian weekend of 13th August 2011, variants of which many of us would have seen before online. And here it goes. Following the breakdown of his factory's production line, costing millions per day, a business owner invites an expert who takes out a screwdriver, turns one screw, and the factory cranks back to life. Presented with a bill for £10,000, the factory owner, who could not understand why the expert should ask for such amount he considered outrageous, demanded a breakdown of the bill. The expert obliged. For turning a screw, £1. For knowing which screw to turn, £9,999. With that, I hope my message is passed as to why it will serve our nation better to speak knowledge. Thank you very much for listening. As I wish both my son, Oluwakorede, who is 13 today, and Nigeria that happens to be 56, happy birthday.